Welcome to the very first episode of Merck TV, where we're interviewing our KOL in chemistry, Anastasios Polyzos. So today we want to find out about you, Tash, and we want to find out about how you have become a key opinion leader in chemistry in Australia. So where do you want to start? How did you get here?
It's a very long and tortuous journey. I guess it all starts with an enthusiasm for science when I was young. When I was growing up, and I grew up in country Victoria in Australia, I always had a curiosity about the environment around me. Growing up on a farm, I used to see life. I used to see how farms worked and how things grew and plants. And from that, that sort of fostered a real interest in science, just trying to understand how things worked. Inevitably, that led to a degree in chemistry at Melbourne. And from there, I finished my degree and then I went to La Trobe University where I completed a PhD. And that was a lot of fun there. What I really got stuck into and developed a passion for was synthetic organic chemistry. And during that time, I think there was a real camaraderie where we went through and we were working late night in the lab every night. You know, I was also a musician at the time, so I was playing in bands and then going back and working in the labs on the weekends and the evenings. So that whole environment was a time where I could really, along with my friends, we really got stuck into the science. And it was really focusing, just living, breathing, eating science 24 hours a day. I think that was nothing like it, and I haven't experienced nothing like it ever since.
It's a real lifestyle doing a PhD, and you really have to have, a really good core group of people around you that get it, that understand, and that are on the same journey as you. Playing in a band on the weekends, where was this? What was happening?
So I was in a band with a couple of really good friends from my younger years. And the story behind it is that we had been around for a while playing weekends, just having fun. But we had a really good songwriter in the band. His name's Gavin McDonough. And really, really got a good songwriter. We had some recordings that his brother took to the Big Brother program. So his brother's a guy named Blair McDonough, who ended up being on Neighbours afterwards.
Yeah.
And I think in one of the shows he was playing our music, and Big Brother asked, "Who's that band?" And he said, "Oh, it's my brother's." So all of a sudden that sort of propelled us into TV and radio and all these sorts of things. So that all happened in the middle of my PhD, which was crazy. So I was having to go into all these TV appearances, and we were playing gigs. And behind all that was still my commitment to my PhD. So there was a real dichotomy between, pursuing a musical career and then also, doing my science.
Is there anything in our daily lives that people might not know has been touched by the kind of science you're in?
Oh, that's a really good question. Look, it's difficult to gauge exactly what the impact of your science might be. Every researcher hopes that, their science will be impactful. And from our perspective with flow chemistry, I think we've been able to engage with industry more broadly. So having seen the transition of what we do at the bench to go into, an industry partner's site and when they can manufacture things such as pharmaceuticals, it's been a really exciting journey for us. So it's knowing that there's a pharmaceutical that's being manufactured in Australia using elements of the technology that we help develop, I think is really humbling.
Let's talk about impactful things and engagement with industry. You have a very innovative piece of equipment that researchers can use in the lab that you were a founder of.
Simple Chem, yeah. So Simple Chem was a company that I was involved in when I was visiting ETH in Zurich. So I was on sabbatical working in Professor Jeffrey Bowe's laboratory. And during that time, they had an interest in developing microfluidics, and were at the forefront of developing chemistry that's suitable to microfluidics. And during that time, we had a couple of ideas around developing new modules for photochemistry that would go into the instrumentation that we're interested in. And from discussions from there, then evolved, the idea to spin out Simple Chem. So ever since then, I've had a very good relationship with the company, and we've been talking about, various products and the chemistries. It's a very innovative product. It's great to see it being deployed around the world now for the automation of chemical synthesis. And I think that's at the forefront of where chemistry should be going. And it's certainly great to see it being enthusiastically uptaken by large pharmaceutical companies, fine chemical manufacturers. And I think it's something that's poised to make a significant impact, especially around drug discovery.
Green chemistry, what do people need to know about green chem? I think it's something that we speak of quite regularly within our own chem communities, but what does everyone else need to know about green chemistry and what's the future?
That's a really good question. I mean, green chemistry is such a, it's such a broad term. So it can be anything from, using the new reagents that that Merck offers, that are compatible with environment, have a low environmental impact, all the way through to new manufacturing processes and, product life cycles, supply chains. There's a whole spectrum of things that need to be considered around green chemistry. So effectively, it's around manufacturing products and developing products with low environmental impact and sustainability. And sustainability is such a broad term as well. It means different things to different people. From a chemistry perspective, obviously, it means being able to move away from hydrocarbons, move into more sustainable carbon sources, low energy inputs for manufacturing. We need to think about those sorts of things because manufacturing process can be very energy intensive. So we want to sort of reduce all of the environmental impact by thinking about all those sorts of considerations. With green chemistry, I think we'll see a lot more of solvents being replaced by Biosource solvents. If you think about the styrene, for instance, I think that's a fantastic product that sees, it's a drop-in replacement for many manufacturing process, and I think that's really exciting. The fact that it's coming from Australia and it's all sourced from Tasmania originally is a wonderful story and globally impactful. So those sorts of products, I think, are going to be really important. And also the narrative will be from students, right at the onset. So right at the beginning of the innovation pipeline, students already thinking about, how can we make this chemical reaction much more green? And they're thinking about products such as styrene. Yeah. The other side to it is in green chemistry, I think we also need to be... We need to do more with less, and when I think about doing more with less, I think about the digitization of chemistry, so making it a much more, sort of moving more into the digital realm.
Yeah.
So if we start incorporating things like machine learning and start planning all of our experiments and letting it undergo sort of a virtual or an in silico type of experiment first, that reduces the number of experiments you have to do in the laboratory. So again, those sorts of things, modeling, digitization and understanding processes really carefully before you actually embark on doing some experimental or process development, I think it's going to be very impactful over the next 10, 20 years.
Is that part of your new project ideas and building in silico parts into your workflow?
Very much so. That's what we're pivoting towards, especially with our flow chemistry and also with our reaction discovery. We're very much interested in developing autonomous flow chemistry systems where you can have a flow chemistry system that's attached to a particular output. So it might be a UV spectrometer, and then the output goes into a machine learning algorithm and then predicts and optimizes a particular reaction on its own without any human intervention. So seeing that sort of technology emerge is really exciting, and having that in the development and experimental pipeline and design, I think, is going to be really important. The other side to it is, designing, synthetic pathways, having a machine-assisted approach to that, I think, will be really exciting. We'll be thinking about disconnections and ways to stitch up molecules together in ways that humans had never even thought about before. So integrating that into our research, I think, is going to be completely transformational. The other side to it is in also not only for flow chemistry, but also thinking about high-throughput experimental design. So we can use devices now where robotics play a major role, and we can do, rather than doing one or two experiments in a day, we can do hundreds of experiments per day. You need to have that integrated with digitization and machine learning. That becomes a very powerful opportunity to discover new chemical processes.
Are researchers ready for that data?
Well, that's a really good point. I think researchers are slowly starting to make the transition into automation. They're becoming much more enthusiastic and much more comfortable with machine learning. The data aspect, I think, is the next challenge. So much data is going to be generated in these types of approaches. And we need to think about how we're going to handle that. So I think that's the next challenge. Fortunately, universities and also research organisations such as CSIRO have wonderful data scientists that you can work and collaborate with, and they can build interface systems and software that which make it a lot easier for chemists to be able to work with. And we need to think about how we're going to train students to be able to embrace that technology. So I think that's the next frontier. I think the adaptation and the deployment of the technology is one thing, but also having students who can speak that language and thinking about how we're going to train students for these future technologies, I think is another challenge that we're embarking on now.
You are, and you've got the ARC, chemistry training facilitation being set up right now. Do you want to talk to us about what's going on in that space?
Yep. So we have a training centre which is being funded by the Australian Research Council, and that's centred around training students to be job ready.
Yeah.
So the training centre is underpinned by a new Master of Industrial Research degree. And that provides students with the opportunity to be trained on site in industry for 18 months, mm-hmm. And they get real world on the job training. So it's slightly different to traditional training, and I think Australia is leading the way in this at the moment. And we're really excited with students being able to go into industry, learn about all these new technologies, such as we've been talking about automation, where industry is really a leader in this as well. And they can learn these technologies, and also coupled with the innovations that we have at university, really take projects that are industry relevant to new levels. And that, of course, ends up helping the local chemistry industry and science in general.
Yeah.
To have a greater impact.
How many students do you have in the program?
In the program, so we have partnered with the University of New South Wales in this. So across it, we have about 30 students in the master's program. In all facets of the chemical industry. So we have students that are working on new process development for pharmaceutical manufacture, all the way through developing new devices for gas chromatography and new inks, for instance. So there's across all facets of the chemical industry. It's really exciting.
Congratulations, Tash. You're really giving back to the industry that's given you so much.
Well, look, we're really fortunate. In Australia, we have a really tight-knit community with chemistry, and academia and chemistry work really well together. And I think that the training centre is sort of more of that glue that helps tie it all together. So it's great to be giving back, but it's also great to be offering students a new opportunity for direct employment and also an opportunity for industry to work with universities much more closely on projects that they probably wouldn't have had, the ability to do in the past. So, it's really exciting. So thank you.
You are an incubator, so thank you. I know you've got a very busy schedule, so we won't keep you too long, but we really appreciate you taking the time to sit down with us and chat about everything chemistry. We really appreciate it, so thank you, Tash.
Thank you, Sarah. It's my pleasure, and thank you to you and to Merck. So you're a wonderful company to work with, and I look forward to working with you in the future.